Yo, Alex here. The Poco F5 is probably one of the most interesting budget devices in the market right now. At least that's how I feel. It has a pretty nice looking design, it's using a Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2 chipset, which is like a nerfed version of the excellent 8 Plus Gen 1, and if you grabbed one during promotions like I did, it costs just under 450 Singapore dollars. So in this video, I want to share some of my thoughts on the device after using it for a while. First of all, let's start with the hardware itself. While the body is mostly plastic and doesn't feel as premium, the lighter weight of the device is something that I really appreciate as someone who doesn't like heavy devices but still wants a big screen and battery. The design of the phone is kinda nice too, especially this frosty looking white variant. There are a few ports that are not as well aligned, which might annoy some folks, but it doesn't really bother me considering this is a budget device. And yes, that's a 3.5mm audio jack, which is something that I really appreciate as well. It's not as good as the one on my LG V50 for sure, but it's not too bad either and sounds relatively clean. Oh, and just like a lot of budget devices in this price range, there is no IP rating or wireless charging here. I've seen some sites saying it has IP53, but Poco's website doesn't. You'll have to pay a little bit more for the F5 Pro if you want those features. It's also worth noting that the fingerprint sensor is a capacitive one that is in the power button. While this might feel like a downgrade to some, I personally don't feel that way. The sensor has been really quick and reliable for me, and the placement is way easier to use compared to devices with an in-display sensor that is placed near the bottom of the screen. Not to mention as well that a lot of expensive foldables and Sony devices are still using these types of sensors, so I don't think it's a downgrade at all. Another aspect that contributes to the aesthetic of the phone is definitely this display. Thanks to the removal of the plastic frame around the screen, it has bezels that are thinner than a lot of flagship devices I've used. While the quality of the display isn't anything amazing, it's still more than good enough for a phone at this price point with decent enough brightness, pleasant looking colours, as well as extra stuff like support for high frequency PWM dimming and 120Hz refresh rate. And bonus points for being a flat display and using Gorilla Glass 5 as well. It even comes with a decent sounding pair of stereo speakers, which makes it a nice device for media consumption. So I personally feel like the overall hardware still punches slightly above its price point. However, I can't quite say the same when it comes to performance, since I think it's actually punching way above its price point. I thought the Dimensity 8100 was a really good chipset when it was used in the similarly priced OnePlus 10R last year, but the Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2 is on a whole other level. Despite being a mid-range 7 series chipset, it performs relatively well even in more demanding games like Genshin and Honkai Star Rail. It can't quite maintain 60fps at the highest graphics, which is to be expected since even some flagship devices struggle with that as well. But it's pretty smooth if I just lower the graphics. I do have to go for a slightly lower settings than what I would have used on my iPhone 14 Plus, and loading speeds are noticeably slower. But for a phone at this price point, I have no complaints. Even the battery life is pretty decent too, so yeah, the Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2 definitely lives up to the hype. It might seem like I care a lot about performance simply because I play these games on my phone, but I think performance is very important for non-gamers as well. Based on my past experiences with budget devices, those with less powerful chipsets typically don't last as long and will start to become sluggish earlier than phones with more powerful chipsets. Now onto the not so fantastic aspects of the phone. The main one for me is going to be MIUI. While I do like a lot of the features that it offers, and the performance of the UI is generally pretty smooth, it still has a bit too much bloatware for my liking, the UI isn't the most modern looking, and some of their own apps still ask for a few too many permissions for my taste. That said, it's still very much usable since I can uninstall or disable some apps, tweak the settings to my liking, and just don't use the apps that require too much permissions. I'm not as particular about these things nowadays since most of my phone usage revolves around third-party apps anyway, and this is probably a big part of why the phone can be priced so aggressively. But if you do care about these things, then you might want to look elsewhere. Last but not least, when it comes to camera performance, it's just okay. The main camera is actually quite decent, but the ultra-wide is pretty meh, the macro camera is still just a waste of space, and the front camera is just usable. I do appreciate the inclusion of a pro video mode, but it only goes up to 4K 30fps, which limits its usefulness to me. Anyway, this is to be expected from a phone at this price point. Often than not, you have to choose between good camera performance or good hardware performance, and for the Poco F5, it's pretty clear that they're focusing more on the latter. Overall, I think the Poco F5 is a really compelling package at this price point. It definitely has a number of compromises here and there, but it does the basics well enough, it looks good enough, I like how light the phone is despite the slightly larger screen, and the performance from the Snapdragon 7 Plus Gen 2 has exceeded my expectations. So if you're looking for a budget device, especially one with good gaming performance, the Poco F5 is definitely worth your consideration.